New Hope TV, your encounter with God.
Let's turn to the first book of the Bible, Genesis chapter 18. Genesis chapter 18, verses 7 and 8. Are you there? And Abraham ran to the herd, took a tender and good calf, gave it to a young man, and he hastened to prepare it. So he took butter and milk and the calf which he had prepared and set it before them, and he stood by them under the tree as they ate. Abraham ran, he took, he gave, and he hastened to prepare. So he took butter and milk and the calf which he had prepared and set it before them, and he stood by them under the tree as they ate. When I was praying about what the Lord would have us hear, what he wanted to tell us, the impression that I got was, be prepared. Be prepared.
You know?
It's a very short word. It's a short word of exhortation. But I believe if it is the Lord and this word is for you, then the word of God will burn in your heart like fire. Hallelujah. The Lord wants us to prepare. Definitely He wants us to prepare for His coming. But this word, you know, and we'll touch upon that, you know, later. But the impression that I got was that the Lord wants us to prepare to be fruitful. The Lord wants you and me to prepare to be fruitful for the glory of His kingdom. We know in Matthew chapter 22, verse 37 to 39, Jesus said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like it, you shall love your neighbor as yourself." This is the first commandment in the sense of the most important, and what is, you know, and that which is ranking topmost in the hierarchy. The most important commandment. But if you look at the Bible in terms of what is the first commandment in chronological sense, in terms of the words that came out from God, then those words are found in Genesis chapter 1 verse 28, where the Lord blessed them and said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply." The very first commandment chronologically was to be fruitful. And so, you know, there is a sense in which we were there in Adam's loins when God spoke this word to Adam. We know later that, you know, Levi received the tithe that Abraham got, or Abraham gave rather, because he was in Abraham's loins. In the same way, when God spoke to Adam and Eve and said, "Be fruitful," we were there. He was speaking to us. And His very first words were, "Write your name," and then He said, "Be fruitful." Genesis chapter 1 verse 28, that commandment has not ceased. Right? That commandment has not ceased. It was there in the Old Testament throughout, still there in the New Testament. The Lord wants us to bear fruit, and much fruit. He gave us this word to be fruitful. He gave us the keys of how to be fruitful, right? He gave us the authority to be fruitful. He gave us the power to be fruitful. He gave us a 24/7 access into the throne room of grace by which we can be fruitful all the time. He gave us the assurance of his presence with us, that so that we may be fruitful. He then filled us with his own Holy Spirit that we might be fruitful. In John chapter 17, he said, I have given them the glory which you have given me. He has given his own glory to us so that we might be fruitful. God wants you and me to be fruitful. And I don't know if any one of us, you know, is being fruitful to our potential, is being fruitful to the degree that the Lord wants us to be. And so hence his word, he's saying, prepare to be fruitful. Sometimes we think that, you know, fruitfulness, being fruitful is for somebody else. That if the, you know, if the Lord wanted me to be fruitful, he would have tapped me on my shoulder and he would have whispered into my ear directly, you know, I want you to be fruitful. But the Lord speaks to us through his word. You know, a large part, you know, of us are guilty of that, of ignoring the commandment to be fruitful. We don't mind coming to church, we don't mind going for a meeting, we don't mind doing all of that, but when it comes to being fruitful, it's something that we are not maybe, you know, focusing enough on. And it's possible to be religious without being fruitful. Or sometimes we think, you know, I'd begun being fruitful maybe 20 years back, 30 years back, and now it's too late. You know, the time has gone by. It's too late. In Genesis chapter 15, verse 1, we read, after these things, the word of the Lord came to Abraham in a vision, saying, do not be afraid, Abraham. I am your shield, your exceedingly great reward. God is telling Abraham by name, just the way he tells each one of us by name. We can put our name on top of Abraham there, saying, I am your shield. The God Almighty is your shield and your exceedingly great reward. Abraham replies, you know, as if this is just yesterday's news. He says, Lord God, what will you give me, seeing I go childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus? Abraham is not excited that God is speaking to him and saying, I am your shield and your exceedingly great reward. Abraham does, you know, that's Abraham's response. I mean, you know, I'm happy, but you know, big deal. Right? Big deal. You can be my shield and my exceeding great reward, but whatever reward is there, I don't have a heir. Abraham reads out his will to God. You know? Abraham wrote his will and is reading out his will to God. I'll read it for you. Okay? I, Shri Abraham Terah, son of Terah Nahor, resident of tent number 8, Terebinth Trees, Mamre, Hebron, pin code, put your pin code, United States of Canaan. Do hereby declare that this is my last will, which I make on this date. I bequeath all my assets to my servant Sri Eliezer of Damascus. I declare that I am in good health and possess a sound mind. This will is made by me without any persuasion or coercion and out of my own independent decision only. I appoint Sri So-and-so to be the executor of my will. In the event Sri So-and-so passes away before me, then Sri X and Y will be the executor of my will. Signed, Abraham Thera. Witness number one, Sarah Abraham. They have signed, Abraham has signed his will and is reading it out to God. The heir of all my assets is Eliezer of Damascus. Abraham has closed that chapter. His last and final testament is there. When he says, I go childless, what he's really saying is, I go to the grave childless. I am going to the grave childless. He has just decided that I'm going to the grave childless. In Hebrews chapter 11 verse 17, we read Isaac as being Abraham's one and only son. In Galatians chapter 4 verse 22, we read that Isaac and Ishmael, the names we read because Abraham had two sons. So Abraham had one son through Hagar when Sarah was alive. Then he had Isaac through Sarah, his wife. And after Sarah died, Abraham marries, he has a concubine, Keturah, through whom he has some six sons. He has written a will sometime back and said, this chapter is closed. He is saying, I'm going to the grave childless. And he's reading out his will to God Almighty. This is what Abraham could see. He saw Isaac, he saw Ishmael, and he saw the six sons. Zimran, Jokshan, Medan, Midian, Ishbak, and Shua. These are the sons that he saw. But God was also speaking about spiritual sons that would continue for a long, long time. Galatians chapter 3 verse 7 talks about those who have faith are the children of Abraham. So Abraham, who wrote his will saying that I am going childless, is still having children every day. Abraham is still having children. He thought he was going to the grave childless, but Abraham is still having children. Abraham signed the will. Sarah was the witness number one. What did Jesus say about the woman who had an infirmity for 18 years? So ought not this woman, being a daughter of Abraham, of Zacchaeus, isn't he also a son of Abraham? Abraham's sons are being born all the time. God wants us to be fruitful. God wants us to be fruitful. Abraham had one son, really, Isaac. But how many children is he having? They say, you know, there's a saying, which I'm just reminded of, that you can count the number of seeds in an apple, right? But you cannot count how many apples are there in a seed. You can never count because it'll just keep, right? God did not just talk about Abraham. In Isaiah 51, it says, look unto Abraham your father and Sarah who bore you. 1 Peter 3:6 says, as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, whose daughters you are if you do good. So Sarah is still bearing daughters. Every woman of God, every newborn woman who is, you know, obedient to the will of God, is now a daughter of Sarah. Sarah, you know, because I'm sure the Lord has given her a way of keeping track of all her daughters. You and I cannot keep track. Every day there's a new daughter being born to Sarah and a new son being born to children being born to both of them. There are many aspects of being fruitful. First, we have to expect to be fruitful. Do not write that will. Please, do not write that will. God has not said, you and I will go to the grave childless. So we should not pronounce that decree over ourselves. God said, be fruitful. When God says, let there be, there will be. Only in this case, he has also, in his graciousness, allowed us to partner with him. When God said, let there be light, he didn't ask light. He didn't ask the sun. But when he said, be fruitful, he told us, come, let's partner and become fruitful. We have to expect to be fruitful. It doesn't matter what it looks like. It doesn't matter if everybody around you has written their will. Please, this is what causes us pressure. It doesn't matter if everybody around you wants to write their will, let them write. But you and I will write what the word of God says, that you and I will be fruitful. Hallelujah. Look at this. Yesterday we heard this verse, Habakkuk chapter 3, verse 17, right? I was just going through that. Though the fig tree does not blossom, number one. Number two, though there be no fruit in the vines. Number three, though the olives fail. Number four, though in the fields there is no food to be found. Number what's there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Though there are no flocks in the fold. Number six, though the cattle are not there in the stalls. So this man is not seeing one thing around him. Not one thing. It's okay, you know, if the fig tree did not do well, and the fruits did not come on the vine, and the olives failed, and you had a bad harvest, and the flocks, you know, were not there among the fold. But at least the cattle is there. It's okay. This man has everything over. Everything is over. Time to write the will. If you ask the, it's impossible for anyone to come out of that kind of situation. Everything, whatever you think, is gone. But God, this he says, yet I will exalt. Yet I will exalt to God. And what does he say? How does he describe God as? The God of my salvation. Even though the situation is a write-off, even though the situation is looks like it's time to write the will, he is the God of my salvation. It doesn't take God any time to turn around. Elisha told the king of Samaria, tomorrow this time, in 24 hours, the situation changed. 24 hours. Then he says, he will make me to walk on the high places. Meaning, I am walking very coolly. I'm not, you know, stuck like a deer caught in headlight. I'm not stuck. I don't know what to do. Go forward, backward, sideways. No. But I am going to walk in the high places. Not in low places, but I'm going to walk in high places. Look at his confidence in the Lord. God has said, be fruitful. If we partner with him, we will be fruitful. Number two, we have to be patient to be fruitful. 2 weeks back, Joseph Sankar was sharing from Luke chapter 8, verse 15, where he's talking about the parable of the sower. And there are many in each of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, you find different shades of how to be, different lessons you can learn from the parable of the sower. In Luke chapter 8, verse 15, it says, the good ground is a noble and good ground, good heart, which keeps the word and bears fruit with patience. To bear a lot of fruit, sometimes you need patience. You have to expect to be fruitful. Abraham had to be patient till he was nearly 100, right? When Sarah had became pregnant. We have to expect, and then we need to be patient. The third, we have to, and this is really the focus, you know, it's a short word, and this is really what I want to say. We have to prepare to be fruitful. God wants us to, this is the word, God wants us to prepare to be fruitful. Please take this word, God wants us to be fruitful. God prepares. God doesn't tell us to prepare. He prepares. Before he made man, he prepared everything. The sun, moon, lighting, stars, you know, moonlight, plants, animals, birds, fish, everything. He prepared everything and then he introduced man.